Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you all to all of you who've come to listen to me. I feel very honoured by such a quality audience. And I should just say that at the end of my remarks, I'm very happy to take any questions about anything. You don't have to have your questions vetted. You just put up your hand and I will listen to your question and do my best to answer. I'm going to speak about Turkey and Britain after Brexit, but I want to say a word, first of all, about tourism. In 1938, the then British Prime Minister, Neville Chamberlain, described another European country, Czechoslovakia, as a faraway country with people of whom we know nothing. I quote directly. Mr. Chamberlain was seeking to justify Britain's appeasement of Adolf Hitler's invasion of Czechoslovakia. Although later damned by events and damned by history, Chamberlain's judgment at the time as to what many British people thought of this country, Czechoslovakia, was not wrong. Few people knew precisely where Czechoslovakia was, fewer still had ever visited it. And for a while, Mr. Chamberlain's decision to sit on his hands, to do nothing, while Hitler rampaged east across Europe, was actually very popular back in the United Kingdom. Now, 80 years on, it would be impossible for any minister to dismiss what are now the Czech Republic and Slovakia as unknown, faraway countries. And it is tourism, above all, which has made the difference. All my adult life, I've seen tourism not just as some optional extra for the affluent, nor for we Brits, simply as a way of escaping from our very temperamental weather, but as something much more fundamental, for visitors and the visited alike, as a means of expanding minds and understanding, as well as a vitally important industry as well. And I should add that I have some direct experience of the business as well. Many years ago, I was a radical student leader. Hard to believe these days because of the colour of my hair and the fact I wear a suit. Almost 50 years ago, I became president of the National Union of Students. And as well as organising demonstrations and campaigning against Margaret Thatcher, who was the Education Secretary, successfully, I might add, we ran a very large travel operation, and I was chairman of it. And it was a pioneering travel operation, opening up markets across Europe and beyond, with bargain basement charter flights and much else besides. So it gave me a taste for the travel business. So I'm very pleased to be speaking today to the World Tourism Forum, representing such a crucial sector of economies across the globe. It's an especial delight for me to be back in Turkey. It's a country I know pretty well, for which I have great affection, and which I visited officially and indeed as a tourist on many occasions. And these days I have the honour to be co-chairman of the official British-Turkish forum known as the Tatlıdil. Next month it's a term of our Turkish partners to host our annual conference. Let me also just go on to, before coming on to directly to Brexit, to say some words of solidarity for Turkey and its people at what is a very difficult time because of terrorist outrages. We in Britain know what it's like to have to live with the threat of terrorism. I'm thinking not just of the current threat of jihadist violence, but the fact for over 35 years in Britain, we had to cope with sustained acts of violence from Republican Irish terrorists. That period was terrible for the people of Northern Ireland. Almost every night, year after year after year, there would be reports on our main television news programme of another atrocity, another killing. But it was pretty awful as well on the mainland of Great Britain, and I can speak from direct experience. I was a young lawyer in early 1973, working in a case at the Old Bailey, our main criminal court. When there was a bomb warning, we went outside, bang. And I was lucky, I just got a small piece of glass in my buttock, but I was very shaken. Other people were not so lucky, and I can still remember that day like it was yesterday. And I also remember the feelings of outrage and of violence which this produced in me for a period after the bombing. I was irrational about issues of that the IRA were raising, about because randomly they had tried to kill me, not because of me, but because I happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. And it's worth being reminded too that this terrorist violence came very close to the murder of a democratically elected Prime Minister, Margaret Thatcher, and the whole of her cabinet, with the bombing of the Grand Hotel in Brighton in October 1984. And had it just not been for an accident of timing, that Margaret Thatcher was not in bed, but she was working, that exactly where the bomb had been planted, she would have been dead, and a lot of her cabinet would have been killed. There were deaths, even so. Now, Irish terrorism on any scale is now thankfully behind us. The peace process of the Good Friday Agreement has produced almost two decades of relative stability and prosperity. But the threat from jihadist violence is ever there. When we suffered our worst recent outrage in July 2005, I was British Foreign Secretary, and I recall, amongst other things, the wonderful solidarity shown to us by the Turkish government, by then Prime Minister Recep Tayyip Erdogan, and the then Foreign Minister Abdullah Gül. We have suffered from terrorism for sure, but Turkey has suffered far more. Moreover, in the United Kingdom, the loyalty of our security and armed forces to the Crown, and therefore to the elected government of the day, is never in doubt. In Turkey, with the experience of the 1960 and 1980 coup d'etat, other military interventions into civilian government, the possibility of another coup may have been at the back of people's minds, but it wasn't out of their minds. And on the 15th of July last year, that possibility became a tragic reality, with 300 innocent people killed and many more injured. Had the timing of the coup, because of leaks, not been advanced by a few hours, a democratically elected government could easily have been overthrown to be replaced by the military. Some countries, which frankly should have known better, were ambivalent at the time about the coup. I'm proud that the British government, from the outset, through our ambassador Richard Moore, showed no such equivocation, and we were outspoken from the first in our condemnation of this outrage. However, I have to say that there is still far too little understanding across Europe about the nature and extent of this almost successful coup d'etat and what would have happened if it had been successful. A combination of jihadist and Kurdish terrorist violence and the July 15th attempted coup has sadly taken a severe toll of the number of tourists visiting Turkey. Total visits in 2016, as everybody knows, were down 30% on 2015. From the United Kingdom, visits were down from 2.5 million in 2015 to 1.7 million last year. But I want to emphasize that the British government remains balanced and proportionate in the advice it gives its citizens about travel to Turkey. The key element of its current travel advisory for Turkey is that it is, quotes, generally safe to travel to Turkey and within Turkey. Though there are the obvious caveats about the need to take additional safety precautions and to avoid the border area with Syria and northern Iraq altogether. Britain's instinctive solidarity with Turkey in its moment of need, the attempted coup, underlines the strength of the relationship between our two countries, especially since the last war. We are both key members of NATO, and unlike some, we both continue to maintain effective defence forces. We are key allies of the United States. We were once both at the centre of vast empires. For Turkey, post the First World War, for Britain, post the Second, we've had to come to terms with the consequences for each of our countries of our imperial days being behind us. Neither of us, neither Turkey nor Britain, has been able to shake off the centuries of connections which empire produced. But amongst other things, this has given both countries a diplomatic ambition and reach which might otherwise belie our position as countries with medium-sized populations only. There's another similarity between Turkey and Britain, well, almost a similarity. Britain is happily entirely surrounded by sea. Makes for good neighbours. Turkey is surrounded by sea on three sides, and I often think that people in Turkey would think that their neighbourhood would be much better if they had fish for neighbours on all four sides, rather than what you do have to the east. Both Britain and Turkey are on the edge of Europe, with, shall we say, a tricky relationship with the European Union. Britain has always been, and on a wholly bipartisan basis, the strongest supporter of Turkey's full membership of the European Union. Indeed, one of the achievements of which I am proudest of my time as British Foreign Secretary is when we had the EU presidency in late 2005, and I was able to bring 36 hours of fractious negotiations to a satisfactory conclusion with a unanimous decision by all 27 countries round the table formally admitting Turkey as an accession state. Now, that happy period for Turkey and the European Union in 2005 now seems light years away. First, there was the financial crisis of 2008, from which Turkey largely escaped thanks to the reforms in Turkey earlier in the decade. But that has created systemic strains on the single currency, the euro. Now, I should tell you personally that I've always believed that a single currency beyond a single country was bound to be fundamentally unstable and bound in the end to fail. There is no example of any single currency beyond a single country which has not failed or has not led to central control over the other countries by the most dominant one. And if you think of the Soviet Union, you had the ruble covering all the federated states within that union. For a time after the collapse of the Soviet Union, they tried to maintain the ruble as a single currency. But it didn't and it could not have worked because each of those individual countries wanted to have control over their economies as a fundamental part of their independence. Now, the reason why single currencies are so inherently unstable is that it forces different countries with different economies to follow the same monetary policy regardless of local circumstances. It strengthens the strong economies within the zone, as it has Germany's, and weakens the weaker economies, as it has Italy's and that of Greece. And these imbalances then lead to demands that fiscal policy, in other words, taxation and spending, should be set centrally, as well as monetary policy. And that is bound to lead to highly significant tensions between member states, as people, the electors in a country, will say, well, hang on, I want my own government to be able to determine our tax levels and whether we spend money on hospitals or schools and where we spend it. I don't want Brussels determining these things. But that's an inevitability of having a single country, a currency. And the euro crisis continues. Read the papers any day this week. Greece appears unlikely to meet the terms of its last agreement with the EU and the IMF on repayment of debt. There is renewed talk of Greece maybe having to leave the euro altogether. So that's the first reason why what happened in 2005 across Europe in Turkey seems such a long way away. Second, there's been the toxic combination of free movement within the European Union, the open borders of the Schengen area, and the Syrian refugee crisis. This would have been difficult for European nations at any time, with or without the European Union. But the way the EU operates, or fails to operate effectively, and the dominance of Germany within the European Union has without doubt exacerbated this crisis. Germany claims to be a nation which is completely committed to the collective decision-making of the European Union, and in many ways it has been. Yet in September 2015, German Chancellor Angela Merkel made a unilateral decision without consulting her neighbours or thinking through the consequences for her own country and the wider region to allow 1 million Middle East refugees into her country. Of course, it was done for the highest of motives, but good intentions do not alone guarantee good policy. As her predecessor Gerhard Schröder commented, she had a strong heart, but no plan. In this case, Mrs. Merkel's decision encouraged many thousands more people to put themselves at the mercy of people traffickers, and it's created immense problems for all the countries en route between the Middle East and Germany, Turkey, Greece, the Balkan countries, Hungary and Austria among them. And if you take Hungary's case, it has reinforced already quite strong nationalist tendencies in that country. Now, despite saying all this, I still do, that for all the European Union's manifold imperfections, it was better for the United Kingdom to remain inside the European Union and to seek to reform it from within than to leave. I worked hard in the referendum campaign for a Remain vote. Indeed, it was something of a family business because our son, William, was the chief executive of the official Remain campaign. But we on the Remain side lost. It may be by only 4 percentage points, but many British governments have been elected on a much lower margin than 4 percentage points. We lost, and we have to accept the result. There won't be, and in my view, there can't be, a second referendum. Now, historians will debate forever why the British voted no. In my mind, there's no doubt that worries about immigration did play an important part in the decision to leave, including some completely made-up, mendacious claims about the imminence of Turkey's membership. But above and beyond this, and the other specific issues of the campaign, like how much we pay into the European Union without getting very much back, there were two more profound underlying sentiments which led a majority of the electorate to vote against the European Union. These were about control and about identity. Britain has for centuries looked beyond its borders. There's an instinctive understanding that international obligations in general produce as many benefits for the United Kingdom as they do responsibilities and constraints on our actions. So we understand that when we sign treaties, we are restricting what we can do, but for wider benefits. But people understand that only when they can see a point in pooled decision making. And the problem for the European Union, and it's a problem right across Europe, was and is that it's gone too far. It's extended its reach and control into matters which it could and should have left to domestic parliaments. Now, there's a very, very long list of issues which could and should have been left to domestic parliaments and which were a source of real frustration for my colleague ministers, for me, for any government across Europe. But I'll just take one example, which is the apparently prosaic issue of the hours that junior hospital doctors should work. How long junior hospital doctors should work, how much they should be trained, you would have thought should be entirely a matter for being settled within a country by domestic parliaments. But owing to extravagant decisions by Brussels, by the European Court of Justice, how long junior doctors can work is now set centrally by the European Union. The British government never asked for these rules. The British Parliament never approved them. They have cost the British Health Service hundreds of millions of pounds for no benefit. And worse, whilst Britain is having to follow these rules, as Northern European countries are, because we have an effective legal system and we follow our legal obligations, countries in Southern Europe, still members of the European Union, are not following these rules because enforcement of rules in these countries, European Union rules, is so difficult and in some cases so impossible. So there's a double standard there too. It's just one example, but you add all those up together, you can see why people got frustrated with the European Union and why those like me who passionately believe, even so, which is, should have stayed inside the European Union, had to keep apologising for things that it had been doing. So the public felt a loss of control, a loss of democratic accountability over key areas of public policy which should have been decided in the United Kingdom. They also, in an imprecise but powerful way, felt some threat to their identity caused by uncontrollable migration from within the European Union. And it's not that Britain has been unwelcoming to inward migration. Far from it. Many areas of the country now have substantial Asian, Afro-Caribbean and African populations, almost always from within the British Commonwealth. In my own former constituency of Blackburn, which I had the privilege to serve for 36 years, one third of the population is now Muslim from India and Pakistan. Came over originally, or their grandfathers did, in the 1960s to work in the textile mills when no white people were willing to work there. There was no unemployment at all. There was a demand for labour. They came over and then gradually their wives and later children joined them. And although this has understandably been quite difficult for the indigenous population, the indigenous population have accommodated this change. It's taken place over time, and crucially, it was based on decisions made by the British Parliament. From time to time, it's been controversial. That's very different from having no effective control at all. Now, next month, British Prime Minister Theresa May will formally give notice to the European Union under the famous Article 50 of the treaties of the United Kingdom's decision to leave the European Union. That notice will expire in March 2019 unless there is unanimous agreement within the European Union to extend it, which I doubt. So we've got 2 years to negotiate our exit. In the coming months, we shall see frenetic activity by United Kingdom ministers and officials to secure trade deals to replace those we've had with and through the European Union. Now, it's no surprise that high on our Prime Minister's agenda has been Turkey. As well as its long-standing position as a strategic ally, Turkey has become an important and increasingly important trading partner for the United Kingdom. Between 2010 and 2016, bilateral trade between our two countries rose from around $11 billion to $17 billion. Though almost all of the increase has been due to growth in Turkey's exports to the United Kingdom, not the other way around. So it's now running at, whereas before it was about, the ratio was 1-1, it's now 2-1 in Turkey's favour. To some extent, this widening trade gap between the two countries is being offset by the United Kingdom's invisible exports of services of all kinds to Turkey. And on top of trade volumes, there are important investments in each other's countries. This mutual reliance makes it imperative for both countries that we reach a deal which, so far as possible, maintains or improves the environment for trade and investment between our countries. I personally am optimistic that that this will be achieved, as it should be with most, if not all, of our trading partners outside the European Union. Now, trade negotiations within the European Union are going to be complicated by the challenge of the so-called four freedoms of goods, services, capital and labour, which the EU purists say are inextricably linked together. There is also a clear wish by some in the European Union to drive a hard, if not a punitive, bargain with the UK to décourager les autres, to deter the others, as the French would say. This reflects a high anxiety within the upper reaches of the European Union that if the United Kingdom is not punished, bears no serious cost for its exit from the European Union, then other countries will follow. There are a number of responses to that. First, the rest of the European Union enjoys a significant trade surplus with the United Kingdom. The rest of the European Union sells us more goods than we sell them. This is particularly true of Germany. Fully one in five of every car manufactured in Germany is exported to the United Kingdom. European manufacturers have a vested interest in trade with the United Kingdom continuing without high tariffs on either side. Second, a punitive response to Brexit is not going to save the European Union from itself. Rather, it's likely to worsen the existential crisis which it already now faces. Anti-EU forces, mainly but not exclusively on the right in other EU countries, were gathering strength before we had our referendum. During this year, there are going to be elections, amongst others, in the Netherlands, in France, and in Germany. It's by no means impossible that there will be a right-wing coalition in the Netherlands, led by Wilders on the far right, nor that Marine Le Pen could win the presidency of France. In Germany, the anti-EU party, the Alternative for Germany, AfD, will not be part of any government, but it could well gain seats into the Bundestag. Meanwhile, in Italy, the five-star movement shows no signs of retreat. Nationalism has become a very strong and potent force in Hungary. A pro-Russian candidate has been elected president of Bulgaria, and Romania is mired in a corruption scandal. And then there are other factors. When Britain leaves the European Union, other member states will have to make up what Britain has been paying. Because for those of you not familiar with the European Union, the better off countries, the established countries, pay into the European Union, and countries which recently joined with lower GDP receive a lot from it. And so famously, Spain and Portugal have received a great deal, and still do, a net benefit from the European Union, which used to lead President Chirac to complain about when he used to fly over Spain and Portugal. He saw all these new roads and new railway lines, which had all been paid for, in his view, by the French taxpayer. But it is about, say, the richer countries giving to the poorer ones. But also, it's not just that. It's about us having it historically to pay for policies which many countries have disagreed with, like the Common Agricultural Policy, which has encouraged inefficiency. At the moment, although you can argue about the exact figure, Britain has been paying net somewhere between €5 billion and £5 billion net into the European Union. Germany is the biggest payer on €9 billion in the last spending round. When we leave, the big payers, Germany, Italy and France, are going to have to face an extra bill for the spending which we were previously paying for in other European countries. And that will produce its own pressures in those countries. The second factor I just mentioned is that we have, for the first time in history ever, a United States president who is openly hostile to the European Union as an idea and who places rapprochement with Russia high on his agenda. At least he has for the last 28 days of his presidency, and every day produces a new surprise. He might say a beautiful new surprise for the rest of the world about what's going to happen next. And alongside that, no surprise here, Russia in turn will seek to widen any splits, any fissures, which are there within the European Union. All in all, the prospects of the European Union surviving in its present form seem much less rosy than they did. Now, every time there's been a combination of countries like the European Union, that combination has convinced itself that it's forever. So the Roman Empire did, the Ottoman Empire did. The sun never set on the British Empire, we were told. I was told at school when a quarter of the globe was pink, because we ran it. But history shows that such combinations of countries are never forever, and that includes the European Union. I do not think that the European Union will suddenly collapse, rather that it will undergo profound changes. One of its fundamental principles has been that there's only one Europe, as it were, one size to fit all, that if you join the European Union, you have to accept everything. All members must take the same conditions of membership. Now, that approach was feasible when the European Union was composed of just 15 Western European member states. But with its expansion east and south, with such wide disparities in income, wealth, and standards of governance within the European Union, that approach is going to break down. In its place, we're going to see Europe a la carte, a two or three-speed Europe, an inner core of Germany, France, and the surrounding countries, a second tier of some southern and eastern European countries, and then an outer ring with some kind of associated status. As for Turkey's still extant application to join the European Union, whether Turkey continues with this, I'm pleased to say, is a matter for the government and parliament here in Turkey and not from me. But on any basis, the European Union is a less inviting prospect than it was back in 2005. And the reduction in support in opinion polls for Turkey's membership of the European Union has been paralleled in many countries within the European Union over the last 10 years of a reduction in support there. Now, one last thing I want to say, and then I'll be, for the last 15 minutes, but let me say I'd be extremely happy to take questions. The other thing that has changed dramatically in the 12 years since that historic decision was made to admit Turkey as an accession state is the situation in the wider Middle East. It wasn't particularly stable 12 years ago, but it has become much less stable, and Turkey has found itself in the middle of this. As many people, many of whom I've met at this Congress, know only too well, terrorism has had a devastating effect on tourist industries across the Middle East, not least in Egypt and Tunisia and other countries as well. I think looking back on this, I think about the Arab Spring, I think that almost all of us involved in foreign policy, myself included, made mistakes when the Arab Spring happened in thinking that it was somehow possible to supplant and replace decades of authoritarian rule, and before that monarchical rule, in the countries of the Middle East overnight by Western-style democracy. We saw elections take place in some countries, most notably in Egypt, where the Muslim Brotherhood under Morsi gained a majority. But what many people who won under these elections didn't realize is that an essential component of democracy is not just that the majority wins, but that in winning, the majority protects the interests of minorities and of the individual. Democracy is never and can never be about the winner taking all. But that, I'm afraid, was the view because there was no other experience across the Middle East. And so we are left with a situation of terrible mess and a terrorist threats in many parts of the Middle East. It will, I'm afraid, take some time to repair this damage. The chances are that we will see the authoritarian regimes that were there before 2010-11 replaced by more or less authoritarian regimes for the foreseeable future, because the institutional basis for change and reform isn't there. And meanwhile, this is an issue that Turkey has very seriously to contend with. Going back to tourism, I said right at the beginning that I celebrate tourism, not just for the benefits it's brought my family and me, the benefits it's brought all Brits to escape from our weather, but because it can work to bring people very much closer together. I think of plenty of examples. But I just take one, which is Vietnam. Now, who would have thought that after that terrible war in Vietnam in the 60s and 70s, that Vietnam would be able to recover and become a major tourist destination? But tourism has been one of the means by which Vietnam has been able to escape its terrible past and also to improve its economy. So tourism is an incredibly valuable industry. It's a means of securing social and political change. And I congratulate all of you involved in this great industry. Thank you very much indeed. Any questions? You can ask me anything you like. Don't all sit there. Yes, sir.
As you all aware, we had latest incidents that were going on actually for more than 2 years between two communities, let's say. But yesterday, suddenly, for more than 10 days, we come up with a point that, you know, those peace talks between two communities, due to NOC's placebit, you know, a decision taken by the Greek side parliament, you know, it suddenly affected all the positive, let's say, surroundings, and, you know, they decided to leave the peace talks. What do you think about one of those guarantors, you know, as a country in Cyprus? What do you think about the future, you know?
Thank you. Well, let me say that my views about Cyprus make me popular in northern Cyprus and not so popular with some elements of the Greek Cypriot political community. We made a really bad mistake across the European Union in allowing Cyprus to join the European Union as members in 2000. In 2004, notwithstanding the fact that under Papadopoulos, President Papadopoulos, the Greek Cypriot people have voted against the peace plan, which the same Papadopoulos had signed at Birkenstock under the auspices of the United Nations. And that has provided the Greek Cypriots with too many cards, and it means that they have little incentive for moving away from the status quo. So it was a major error. It happened. I was very hopeful that these peace talks between moderate leaders on both sides would produce a benefit. They've been disrupted at the moment by this argument about Enesis, which goes back to a vote in Cyprus amongst the Greek Cypriots in 1950, which is a very long time ago. I just pray hard that the negotiations will resume. My own view, and I put this in, I've spoken about this in our British Parliament, and I've written about this, is that if there is not a deal, then the international community needs to contemplate partition of Cyprus between North and South. People say you can't do that, but it's been a solution elsewhere in the world, in many places. And if the international community made it clear to the Greek Cypriots that if they didn't start to negotiate seriously, then the international community would endorse partition, then I think negotiations might be more quickly advanced. Thank you. Any more questions? Yes, madam. Yep, hello. Is there a microphone for this lady? Why don't you come here and ask it, as you're in charge anyway.
During the coup attempt in Turkey, what did you think if such a thing has happened in your country while you were on duty? What things might be done?
It's very hard to imagine this idea in Britain because the British armed forces have been loyal to the crown for at least four centuries. We had a lot of internal trouble in the 15th century and parts of the 16th century. We had insurrections. We had a civil war in the 17th century and the occasional rebellion in the 18th century, in 1715 and 1745. But the loyalty of our armed forces has not been in doubt since then. So it's impossible to imagine, and it's in Britain. All I can say is that, and because I used to talk to friends in Turkey before the coup about whether the armed forces would ever operate in that way again, as they had in the two explicit coups in 1960 and 1980, and in the so-called coups by memorandum in 1971 and 1997. And the view was, well, it's possible, but very, very distant possibility. If it had been me, I would think my reaction would have been the same as those of ministers and others I've spoken to, of great anger, of fear, and a concern for one's families and one's friends and so on, and great sadness as well as anger about the loss of life. I would also, I hope, but this is very difficult, ensure that my response after that was a proportionate one and one which helped to bind the country together. But it's very difficult for me to say because it's an experience that no British minister in the 20th century, 19th century, the 20th century and the 21st century is ever going to have. Okay. I'll take one last question if you have one. Anybody has one? Otherwise, thank you very much indeed. Bonne chance. Thank you.